Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel, MD, general physician. Today we'll be talking on another topic in endocrine, that is female hypogonadism. You do come across once in a while cases of hypogonadism in a female. So the meaning is very simple. If there is a decreased function of gonads, that is ovary, in female, you will call that as hypogonadism. We'll be discussing under this common heading, definition, etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, investigations, diagnosis, treatment, etc. Hypogonadism in a male is a clinical syndrome, results from the failure. Sorry, this is wrong, something wrong. This should be female. In an ovary, to produce a physiological level of estrogen and normal ovulation. And this may be because of disturbances in or damage to hypothalamic pituitary gonadal axis, which we will call as secondary or primary failure of ovary. So two functions, major function of ovary, that is ovulation and estrogen production. If one or both are affected, we'll call that as hypogonadism. Sorry, this should be female. Sorry. There's a typing mistake. There's also one term. So primary means basic pathophysiology in ovary itself, where hypothalamo-pituitary gonadal axis is working, but ovary is at a fault. But if this hypothalamo-pituitary gonadal axis is affected, we call that as a secondary, or it is also called as a central causes. And there is another variety we call as a late onset hypogonadism, meaning in the late stage, slowly there is a decreased production of estrogen or there is absence of ovulation. Then it is called as a late onset of hypogonadism. So basically it is divided into primary and secondary. We have already told you. Primary is because of a failure of a ovary itself. But hypothalamo-pituitary gonadal axis is still working. So there is normal or increased level of gonadotropic releasing hormone or FSH-LH. While in secondary, there is a failure either of hypothalamus or failure of pituitary, where you will have a decreased level of FSH-LH with decreased ovulation and decreased estrogen production by ovary. Secondary due to either pituitary or because of hypothalamic failure. So, very clear, either because of hypothalamus or pituitary, it is a secondary ovary failure. And if ovary itself is damaged, we call it a primary ovary failure, where you got a normal level of, normal or high level of gonadotropic releasing hormone or FSH-LH. So, this pituitary and hypothalamic causes are also called as central, while ovarian causes are called peripheral. In central causes, as far as pituitary is concerned, trauma, tumor, vascular, congenital defects, or it can be hypothalamus, which is again can be traumatic, tumor, or vascular, or you can have increased production of prolactin secondary due to drugs or because of prolactinomas. Or there is a condition called as empty cella syndromes. Or there can be luteal phase defects. These are the causes, what we call as the central causes. Or we also use the word hypothalamo-pituitary gonadal axis failure. Peripheral defect is mainly with ovary, that is ovarian tumors or damage to ovary because of infection, trauma, vascular, or because of radiation, surgery, or there may be conoidal dysgenesis, which can be congenital defects, or there's a premature ovarian failure, or there may be resistance of ovary from action of FSH-LH. There's a third group which they put in ovarian problems, that is called metabolic disease, where because of polycystic ovary, there is a anovulation, or it can be because of hypothyroidism, obesity, or maybe because of adrenal gland like androgen excess, we call as congenital adrenal hyperplasia, where there is an excess of androgen excess, and that can also produce failure of ovary to have an ovulation. As far as genetic defect is concerned, there is one syndrome called as a Kallmann syndrome, where there is anosmia and gonadotropic releasing hormone deficiency. This is 1 in 10,000 female to male ratio. Male to female ratio is 4:1. And there is very low level of testosterone, FSH and LH. While other pituitary functions are usually normal. You can find out this particular defect by doing an MRA where there is an absence of olfactory bulb. The olfactory bulb is not developed. And as far as treatment part is concerned, you will have to give testosterone because there is severe hypogonadism. Male testosterone hormone is nearly undetectable, very low or undetectable. So you'll have to give testosterone from outside as well as gonadotropic if there is infertility. There is one big group they describe as idiopathic hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, which is again can be acquired or can be genetic. Very commonly it is because of genetic causes where you can have a genetic receptor gene mutations. And there is one more condition which we call as adrenal hypoplasia congenita or hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. This particular word is commonly utilized. So in this particular variety, there is a decreased production of hormones, and that will produce group of symptoms and signs where you will have a hypogonadism. So adrenal gland is at fault here, and that produces hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So secondary to gene mutation, you can have a partial idiopathic hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, or there may be complete. In partial, there is a low level of LH-FSH and there is an incomplete pubertal development. While in case of a complete defects, you will have a total absence of pubertal development and there is no response to gonadotropic releasing hormone. Even if you give that, there is no response. So these are the different congenital defects which can be at the level of hypothalamus or can be at the level of pituitary or at the level of gonads. So I'm not going into detail in regarding that particular part. There are good number of congenital defects and these are all different type of genetic abnormalities. There is one more condition we call as a Noonan syndrome, which is autosomal dominant, which is also called as phenotype of Turner syndrome, where it is called left-sided in Turner's. There is a right-sided congenital heart defects. There is epicanthal fold. There is an abnormal position of the ears, that is low-set ears, short stretches, webbed neck, crepe orchidism. Good number of time, 50% of males will have a crepe orchidism and there will be hypogonadism. This will be more common in a male. It can also affect female also. Can affect either sex. Can affect also female. As far as secondary causes is concerned, very commonly it is because of hyperprolactinemia, gonadotropic releasing hormone analog therapy, person who is on a long-term glucocorticoid therapy, or because of a chronic illness, or because of a critical illness remaining for a longer period, diabetes mellitus, person who is consuming opiums, pituitary mass lesion, infiltrative disease, surgery on cella, that is on pituitary gland, or there is a radiotherapy for pituitary gland, or very rare causes, hemochromatosis. And this will usually produce a mixed variety where you will have a primary, little primary defect as well as secondary hypogonadism. So this is a diagram showing you how the gonadotropic hormones is acting at the level of ovary and what are the effects on ovary, uterus, etc. We have already discussed in a female hormones, so I'm not discussing in detail here. But at your leisure time, you can go through this particular diagram. So this is a normal hypothalamic pituitary axis. Hypothalamus will release GnRH, which will act on anterior pituitary releasing FSH-LH. We have already discussed in female sex hormones that LH will be acting on an ovary, giving rise to ovulation, and also it will stimulate the production of estrogen and progesterone. FSH will stimulate female secondary sex characters, will be stimulated by estrogen. Uterus, cervix, fallopian tubes, development and preparation for fertilized ovum will be prepared by FSH. So this will give rise to what we call as the preparations of uterine endothelium for fertilized ovum to get implanted and then further develop into a fetus, as well as LH will stimulate the production of estrogen. Also, there will be production of inhibin and activin. Inhibin will inhibit FSH. Activin will stimulate FSH production, depending upon that. Progesterone will further help in further development of pregnancy. And fluctuating level of estrogen and progesterone will produce normal menstrual cycle. Now, in a person who has got hypothalamo-pituitary axis dysfunction, then there will be decreased production of either GnRH if the hypothalamus is at fault, or if pituitary is at fault, FSH-LH level will be reduced. Then we call that as a hypothalamo-pituitary gonadal axis dysfunction. And this will be central causes, or we call it the secondary causes. But if ovary is at fault, say here ovary is at fault. So because ovary is at fault, we call it a hypogonadism. And here, there's a decreased production of estrogen. There is no ovulation. So there is a decreased level of estrogen level. But hypothalamo-pituitary axis is working, so this production continues. So there will be either normal level or increased level. There is no inhibition by estrogen, and as there is no inhibition by estrogen, FSH-LH level is also high, and even GnRH level may be high. So this is the reason why it is called hypergonadotropic. So these are normal or elevated, and there is a decreased production of estrogen. So that's why you will have a low sex hormone level. So estrogen level, progesterone level will be low. So this is that particular axis, how it is acting, etc. is again shown in these photographs. You can go through. This is estrogen production from cholesterol, how it is converted from cholesterol to an estrogen. You will have a production of intermediate products like testosterone, and that testosterone will be further converted by aromatase enzyme into estrone and estradiol, and that will be done by FSH. that will be done by FSH, while LH will increase the production of testosterone up to this level, and then FSH will be further working. So this is GnRH, which will be acting on a pituitary, which will produce FSH-LH. LH will be acting, it will give rise to ovulation, and there will be production of ovum and corpus luteum, and that corpus luteum will now produce estrogens, while FSH, while acting on an ovary, it will have a secondary sex character, sexual hair, breast development, etc. And it will be also acting on a follicle, and this follicle, it will help in ovulation, as well as there will be also production of inhibin and activin. Inhibin will inhibit pituitary gland to reduce the production of FSH-LH. Also, it will inhibit E2, that is estrogen, will inhibit at the hypothalamic level and will reduce the production of GnRH. So this is what we call as the regulation, what will be taking place in a female. We have already shown you that. This is a normal menstrual cycle. So FSH level will give rise to ovulation. There will be formation of a follicular phase. FSH level will be slightly elevated. You will have ovulation, corpus luteum formation, and then FSH level will fall. Even LH level will be also decreasing, and here, now because of decrease in the progesterone and estrogen level, now you will have a secretory phase followed by a menstrual cycle. So this will be normal menstrual cycle what will be taking place in a female. So this is a combination. This is what is happening to FSH-LH. When FSH-LH level rises, estrogen level is elevated. When FSH-LH level falls, progesterone level is elevated. And this will be the phase where secretory phase is there, or we call luteal phase. So before FSH-LH, that is what is called as a follicular phase. And when FSH-LH levels are elevated, you will have ovulation. And that usually is on the second week, that is day 14. And then at 28, the level of progesterone also falls, FSH-LH also falls, and you will have a menstrual cycle. This is FSH acting on an ovary. There will be end of menstrual period. Then you will have an action of FSH. Estrogen level will be secreted. You will have a follicular phase. Now you will have a FSH-LH both being elevated. You will have a now further increased production of a estradiol. You will have a follicular phase, ovulation. Follicular phase will be converted into ovulation. And then you will have a, that corpus luteum will now produce progesterone, and you will have a secretory phase. And then you will have a normal menstrual cycle. That is what will be happening. This is shown what are the changes, what is taking place. So you will have a follicular phase, ovulation, once there is an ovulation, corpus luteum formation, and then slowly mature corpus luteum, then it will undergo atrophy. So we call as a regression of a corpus luteum and corpus albicans. So this will be the normal cycle what will be taking place in an ovary during each menstrual cycle. So this is what is going to take place. Primary follicle, completely developed follicle, mature follicle, and you will have ovulation. And once there is an ovulation, now it goes into luteum, we call it a corpus luteum formation. And then it will undergo atrophy, giving rise to corpus albicans. So that is how the complete phase is there. This is regarding a menstrual cycle. These are the hormones which are being there. FSH-LH on 14th day. The level will fall during a reproductive period. This will be the fluctuation of FSH-LH level. This is FSH level, this is LH level. And in a postmenopausal, the level rises. Level will rise during a menopause and postmenopausal period. And slowly the person will have a total anovulation. I am not going to discuss in detail regarding polycystic ovary syndrome. We'll be discussing separately in detail. This is a negative feedback. What we already told you, that estrogen and progesterone will have inhibitory effects on antidepituitary as well as hypothalamus level, as well as at the level of hypothalamus. And there will be one hormone which we call as the inhibin, which will be also produced by LH, and that will inhibit at the level of pituitary, inhibiting FSH-LH production. So GnRH stimulates the release of FSH, which will be acting at the level of the mature follicle, will give rise to the increased production of estrogen, which will stimulate hypothalamus. LH will stimulate the corpus luteum, and there will be ovulation. Corpus luteum will now produce progesterone. It will be producing secretory phase, and it will be also preparing uterus for what we call as fertilized ovum for implantation. If it doesn't take place, now corpus luteum undergoes atrophy. It will be converted into corpus albicans, and the menstrual cycle will start. So no longer stimulation. Now progesterone will inhibit hypothalamus. No further release of GnRH. No release of FSH-LH. And you will have a menstrual cycle. As far as estrogen production is concerned, estrogen will have effect on female genitalia, other endocrine organs, central nervous system, breast, secondary sex character, as well as also it lowers cholesterol lowering action. While progesterone will take part in uterus development, breast development and brain. And there's a cyclical changes which will be taking place in the cervix and vagina. And if fertilized ovum gets implanted, it will take part in maintenance of pregnancy. In a hypogonadism, there's a low sex steroid hormone, so there is a poor pubertal development or no pubertal development in a complete hypogonadism. So FSH-LH level will be low if there is a secondary failure of pituitary gland, where FSH-LH level will be low. But if it is a primary failure of ovary, then FSH-LH level will be normal or high, because there is now no longer negative feedback mechanism. In an idiopathic hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, short form it is called IHH. It is very common in female. Usually female will have amenorrhea. It is almost irreversible, and there is a delayed puberty. There is very low level of FSH-LH. Usually there is no CNS lesion in pituitary gland or hypothalamus. There is normal prolactin level, normal thyroid, normal adrenal gland, meaning there is no CNS lesion involving hypothalamus, pituitary gland, thyroid and adrenal gland. But still there is a low level of FSH-LH, and that is given a name, idiopathic hypogonadotropic hypogonadism. So very, very important, there will be decreased level of testosterone, decreased level of estrogen, low FSH-LH, and normal prolactin, normal thyroid, normal adrenal gland, and absence of CNS damage, that is to pituitary gland and hypothalamus. I've already discussed regarding a Kallmann syndrome, that is idiopathic variety of hypogonadism, hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, where you will have an absence of olfactory nerve or olfactory bulb, which will produce anosmia. With neurological symptoms and signs, you can have a visual abnormality, synkinesia, you can have a renal abnormality, midfacial defects, and it is a sex-linked recessive disorder. These are the female sex hormone, estrogen, progesterone. There are natural estrogen called estradiol. which is from testosterone by aromatic enzyme. That will is taking part in sex differentiation. So because of hypogonadism, now you will have a defect in sex differentiation. You will have a psychological problems also. There is one another variety called as a triple X phenotypes or genotypes, where you have got the 3X. Female will have a poor sexual development, scanty menstrual period, mental retardation. There will be a normal plasma testosterone level, high level of FSH-LH, and high plasma level of estradiol. There is a positive sex chromatin test. You will be able to identify there are triple X. So that particular combination, when you come across, you call triple X syndrome. There is another condition where it is called a monosomy, where it is a another variety of a Turner's, where it is XO and it is a 44 chromosomes. There is an ovarian dysgenesis because of XO karyotype. Puberty is delayed, scanty menstrual period, amenorrhea, primary infertility, and there may be absence of even a breast tissue. We call it as amestia, and that is very commonly we call it as a Turner syndrome monosomy, XO chromosome. This is Turner syndrome where there is mental retardation, dwarfism, waped neck, fold of the skin on the side of the neck. There is ptosis. There is a face with a peculiar, with a low hairlines, epicanthus, low set ears, micrognathia, small jaw, and coarctation of aorta is quite common in Turner syndrome. There is one another variety called as a pseudo-hermaphroditism, where genotype-wise female, the gonads and internal genitals are feminine, like ovary, oviducts, uterus are present, but they are maldeveloped. Pre-pubertal age, there is a masculinization, there is a diamond-shaped pubic hairs, there is a development of glands, penis, increased plasma level of testosterone and androgens. This is very peculiar, we call pseudo-hermaphroditism. In a male, there is because of androgen resistance, a male will develop a gynecomastia, testicular feminizing syndrome. There's a defective testicular development. There's a defect in 17 alpha hydroxylase enzyme deficiency. So testosterone development is poor. And there's a congenital blockade of pregnenol formation, pregnenol formations. And this gives rise to pseudo-hermaphroditism in male. This is estrogen and related drugs which are available, which are commonly utilized for what we call as in infertility. I'm skipping over this particular slide. These are progesterone preparations. As far as investigation is concerned, you have to suspect and you will have to differentiate from two common conditions, that is central causes and primary defects in ovary. As far as treatment part is concerned, in a case of a hypogonadotropic hypogonadism, because there is a decreased level of gonadotropes, you will have to give gonadotropes from outside. So by and large, the main treatment will be induced secondary sex character by giving steroids, that is estrogen and testosterone. And whatever hormone levels are less, you can replace that hormones from outside. That is replacement of a pituitary hormones. Whatever hormones are missing, main hormone which are missing is either GnRH. In case of a hypothalamic damage, you will have to give GnRH. And if pituitary gland is a defect, you will have to give FSH-LH. And sometime you require even a replacement of a thyroid hormones, etc. It is called menopausal hormonal therapy and hormone replacement therapy. For vasomotor symptoms, for osteoporosis, for vaginal dryness, urogenital atrophy, and for cardiovascular disease, during menopause, when you give, it is called menopause hormonal therapy, or it is also called as hormone replacement therapy during menopause. And these are some of the common symptoms which occurs, and for relief of those symptoms you will use that hormone replacement therapy. It is also used in senile vaginitis, delayed puberty, dysmenorrhea, increased acne, dysfunctional uterine bleeding, and in a male, CA prostate, estrogen is utilized. It is also, estrogen is used as contraceptive. It is also used as a hormone replacement therapy in dysfunctional uterine bleeding, in a female with endometriosis, premenstrual syndromes or premenstrual tension, threatened abortion, habitual abortion, and also in a case of an endometrial carcinoma. In this condition, estrogen is utilized. As far as complication is concerned, mainly it will give rise to infertility and poor development of secondary sex characters. And person, female, will have an ovulatory cycle. So, I end my lecture here. I hope this will be helpful to you.